How are we doing today? Welcome to the Art of Eve presentation, past, present, and future. I am CCP Bluescreen.
And I am CCP Merkur, senior VFX artist.
I'm a senior 3D artist.
We are part of a 30-man strong Eve art, effects, and audio team, also known as Team TriLambda. And here we have them, our awesome colleagues at Team TriLambda, 2D artists, 3D artists, VFX artists, audio design, QA analysts, graphics programming, tool programmers, and tech art.
Today we'll be looking at some of the things this team has delivered to you guys during the past year, since we last met here at Harper. We'll also be looking at some of the things that we're currently working on, and showing a bit of what's coming in the future. So starting our year in review, we'll walk through some of the things we've been doing with characters and apparel, and we'll look at some ship redesigns we've done, skins, structures, and some ideas and concepts of future environments, visuals that we've done. But first up, we have some visual effects.
So first up last year was the introduction of the Citadels. There was a massive amount of new VFX we had to create for like 50 almost modules for the structures, and then super weapons as well. Doomsday weapons for the supers. It's the four horsemen. Yes. And we also had to create a special tethering effect, which is a special kind of stretch effect for tethering on the structures, which morphs a bit to your ship, which no other effect in Eve does. And we also created the point defense batteries, which do AoE damage around the structures. Yes. So, in summer last year, we updated the visual damage system. The armor hardeners were made to be racially colored. We extended the visual damage system also to include world objects and structures. And then we also made this new hull repair effect. For all you guys who like to hull tank. The Rorqual was up next with its new panic button. I love that image. And then we did the command bursts. And we also differentiated the effects between warp disruption and warp scrambling, which used to be the same effect, as well as updating the effect for triage mode on the foxes. Then we did some effects for the MPE, which kind of served to highlight some points in there, like this fox ship being controlled by drifters and stuff swirling into the vortex after the battle. And we also took a couple days after creating the new explosions last year to create different kind of explosions, namely fireworks. These are all way larger than the previous fireworks we have released. And here's a short video of them from the Christmas of Seven show with some really delightful Eve Christmas music. So the plan for these was for them to come out as rewards. Oh, sorry.
Merry Christmas.
Yeah. The plan for these was for them to come out as possibly for rewards for events in the game or from the EVE store at some point, possibly in the next year or more to come. So I'm just going to show you one more of these. This one's my favorite, the Blood Raider one, because they're all factionally or racial themed. And this is my favorite because it actually takes the shape of a Blood Raider cathedral, which you might have seen in the dungeons in the game. And then we finally did the new post-processing, which brings dynamic exposure and tone mapping to EVE, which really ties the color range of your entire space scene together and makes your camera and screen react to light in a really cool way. Then, with the overhaul of the mining barges, we decided to get them some new VFX, as well as utilize our state machine to turn the fires off and on, depending on whether you are in warp or not. With these updates to the mining barges, we can't really leave out the warp well forever. So earlier this year, it got its own makeover, both in texture and effects. And here you see some of the new hazard lights it has when it's in deploying or undeploying, and new fire effects. Also, last year, we released the new explosions in Ascension. And we really hope you've been enjoying blowing things up more than before. And of course, we have the new sounds coming in the next release. And we talked a bit about them yesterday in the graphics talk. And you might have seen them in the keynote, or if you've been on the test server lately, I'm seeing a lot of screenshots from there. Let's look at this before and after again. I really, really like this blue one, but the overwhelming favorite by most people, it seems to be the pink one, which is a bit surprising. So, some good improvements being made there, I think, and enriching the environments of EVE. And also in these new zones, there's perhaps all manner of color you might not have seen in EVE before. probably more vibrant than it's ever been. But that's okay, I guess, since it's only in one place in every system, right? And we really hope you enjoy checking them out when they come out in just a couple of weeks. And on to completely different things. The character department has been really busy.
Yes. So, let's look at some of the things that our character artists have been up to the past year. Starting with the Crimson Harvest event, we deliver a line of Blood Raider themed apparel, jackets and shirts, pants and much more. Also, we got to make a line of caps and berets for you guys. See them here. And our character department also worked with the team behind the Mentors initiative to deliver these cool caps for you. You might have seen these in game. And then we continuously work on delivering new clothing lines for New Eden. The latest of these, some of which should be coming your way soon, is the exploration line. Here's the female that's wearing a Kaldari version, and the male is wearing an Ore version of the exploration line. And here you see the died. Can we try that again?
Yeah. Another crash.
All right, so here we see the four main Empire variations. If you missed some of it, that's some really, really cool material details we see here. See some different patterns for the different empires. This is following up on the combat suit line. We wanted to make something lighter, more planetary exploration kind of thing. It's a full suit. And it's the first time we've equipped the EVE pilots with sidearms, too. It's probably the most complicated suit we've ever made in EVE. It's very cool. Yeah. So let's look at some ship skins also. Continuing in 2016 and this year, we've been building on the available ship skins lines and designer lines. This is the fire cell line on the SOE. And there's a few more examples here of what's been coming out in the last year. I'm not going to be running through everything from the past year. What might be more interesting is the new technology we use to actually apply this to our hulls. That we put that in place since we met here at FanFest last year, and talking about the pattern projection technology, the PPT. I just want to try and quickly take you through the basics of this process and how it works. So if we begin from the basic, we can take an apocalypse and strip it of all its materials. It still has all its material areas. We've just applied the same material to all of them here. So we can start by projecting a single pattern texture onto the ship, and it will tile every direction up and down. We use two projection textures, so that works in combination to create a composite pattern. So here we have both of them working. Still tiling up and down, and like we can scale that as we want to. And right now we're just projecting onto the entire ship. We can choose which areas we want to project the textures onto, so we can, for instance, eliminate what is usually the gold area. We could eliminate all the other areas as well, so we have control over that. Also, of course, the projection can be at any angle and position. Right now, for simplicity, we're just projecting straight onto the x-axis in the middle of the ship. And then we can clamp it. So here now, the projection isn't tiling anymore. It's just drawing once, straight where the projection is applied. Or we can have it running. We can have one texture running down the side. So here we continue the projection down the z-axis, still not drawing on the gold areas. In that area. And then, of course, we can now apply materials again. So let's put some nice blue metal there on the gold and some tech metal, and let's make nice and shiny silver on the hull and some copper details. Now, that's the four materials we have on any normal V5 ship. But with the pattern projection, we actually get one material per projected pattern also. So we go all the way up to six materials, which is actually another really cool part of the projection stuff. So we can put a beautiful green material on the club there and some red metal. So now we have six materials on this ship. And we can pull up the textures again, change out like one of them. We can change out one of the patterns there. We get a different pattern. We can change out the materials as we want to. Again, switch out both the patterns, get a completely different look. So this is pretty sweet. This is the very basics of it, and there's other things, of course, to consider here. So for every ship and every skin, you have to set the projection specifically for every hull in the game. There's the pattern mirroring and asymmetrical ships, and animated ships, of course. So there's a few more things to it, but this is the basics, and it's enabled us to create some pretty cool stuff. So now that we all have an intricate understanding and of the theory and application of PPT skins, let's look at a couple of examples of what we have delivered using this this last year. Of course, first we delivered the Star Captain skin. Then we used it for the Guardian Gala ships as well. Glacial Drift for the Alpha ships only. Converge Nova for the Mortal ships. And for the Kaldari ships, the ITC skins. And we have another one that we just finished working on that should be coming your way in the not too distant future. It's an SOE shipline exclusive. Here we see it on the Stadius. We don't have an official name for this one yet, I think, but we call it the Foxtrot in the art department. Obviously. Smooth progressive dance characterized by long, continuous flowing movements. Yes, that's the Foxtrot. So another thing worth mentioning when talking about skins and projection is the upcoming refactoring of the Tech 3 ships. And without going into details about what this refactoring means for the individual hulls of the Tech 3 ships, I think it's worth mentioning that this will finally allow us to put skins on the Tech 3 ships, which I'm sure some of you have been waiting for a bit. So you see it applied to the Legion. This has been a long-standing request and obviously something we wanted to do in TriLambda for quite some time. And so we finally managed to get rid of the bloggers, both technical ones and content issues. And we're happy to finally deliver this. Here we see it on the Minimatar Loki, in different variations. And moving on from the skins, let's have a look at what has been happening in regards to ship redesigns. We've continued on that, obviously, since we last met here. Last September, or Ship-tember, as we called it in TriLambda, we shipped a package of 7 redesigns, which, including the Tech 2 variations and mining barges, added up to a total of 16 unique hulls. So that was quite a package for us. You're probably familiar with most of these now, but let's have a look. So the redesign process is always very interesting for us. I mean, we always try and reflect more of the actual functionality of the ships when getting to look at them again. Here on the probe, we got to add the missing drone bay, which is not featured on the Cheetah. And on the Cheetah, we got to work on, you know, the characteristic square Thucker sails. And the process of the build is also very different and varies from ship to ship and artist to artist. On this ship, for example, we didn't do too much in the way of traditional 2D concept design. We made a bunch of blockouts and did a lot of work in 3D and rendered from there. And then the image you see here was basically painted on top of the already finished low poly model. And this is basically the extent of the concept process. And again, the process was similar for the Slasher redesign. The extent of the concept is pretty much this. The rest was worked out back and forth between concept and 3D. And also, obviously, we continued to add warp animations to all these ships. And for the Minmatar one, for these two ones, as is often the case for Minmatar, the sails made good candidates for animation. And so, like I touched on before, the process varies. For this one, for instance, for the Mauls and the Keras, we had a much more developed concept, so it was a much more technical concept. You see that here, where you have, you know, a more technical drawing with like orthographic views and some tech details and a Tech 2 variation before the 3D process even starts. And it also depends. So it depends on the artist. The Mollus here was redesigned by CCP Cayman, who also designed it some 15 years ago, the original one. While the Griffin here was redesigned today, exactly 2 years ago, it was posted on the net by CCP Pointy Bits, who at that point wasn't actually working at CCP. So I think this is a mix of continuity and new input, which is very much mirrored also in our community. It's really interesting and brings something to this process of maintenance and renewal of the Eve ship line. Here again, we have some in-development material on the Griffin, showing the 3D concept and 2D being thrown back and forth with some paint overs in there and 3D models. And that brings us to the Bantham. The reasons for redesigning any specific ship can be many. The assets can be technically outdated, which means that we can't use the new shaders, we can't, you know, fit the turrets we want to, or maybe we can't even apply the new boosters, or the mesh or the textures themselves can be outdated, preventing, you know, applications of skins and projecting technology. And then sometimes, you know, it's just time for a makeover. So where do you start, like, rematching the asset list? But because, of course, it's a lot of people have been flying around this ship for many, many years. So it's a balance between, you know, respecting the old and imagining the new. So here we have some initial sketches, redrawing the inspiration of the original and defining features for this asset, while respectfully redesigning, you know, features maybe less cared for. And then we just keep developing on the concept, going back and forth on shape, form, and functionality. Never afraid of asking the tough questions, you know. Too much like a Merlin. Also, we had managed to have a look at the Executioner, including its Tech 2 variations, the Crusader and the Malediction. And actually here, all three hulls have unique features, with the Malediction and Crusader having additional armor plating on the front sides. And often we'll develop concepts to flesh out specific ship functionality, like animation, warp animations and stuff like that. Here, we're trying to nail down exactly that, the warp animations. And again, here are some technical concepts for the Tech 2 variation. So the last ship we looked at for the ship timber release was more of a ship line itself. It's of course the mining barges and the Exhumers. I mean, we've been wanting to give these ore ships some love for a while and have them on the drawing board for quite some time. And here we went with a more modular approach that meant we could redo the entire line in one go. The main difference between the different ships being simply the size of the hull, the length, and the amount of ore processing energy cores we have on each of them. And as CP Mirka mentioned earlier, we had some really cool effects also here to distinguish them. So since the madness of September, we have managed to squeeze in a few other redesigns. In March, we delivered the first capital redesign with the Chimera. And this ship was quite a technical challenge, and we've had it on the drawing board for quite some time, trying to figure out exactly how to deal with a ship of this size. The main challenge here is the size and how to best sell that scale through textures and mesh details. Because as ships and structures grow in size constantly, we can't simply keep growing the textures and upping the poly count. So we have to find other solutions. And with the Chimera for the first time, we utilized some of the shader technology that was developed for the structures. Through a detail shader, we can simply tile a number of detailed normal maps on top of the ship's already applied original unique textures, so that when you get close up, you get a more detailed view. And also in March, we released the Cormorant, along with its Tech 2 variant, the Flycatcher. Main difference here, apart from the obvious Caligota black and red skin, is the sensor arrays and electronics on the wingtips and on the front. And here again, we have some concepts on different animation states of the ship. Now, obviously, we still have some stuff in the pipeline. As always, we have ships coming your way. We have ships just in the early stages of production. One of the ships that should be coming your way, not too far out, is the Vexra, that you have maybe already noticed in the keynote on Thursday. Here we have the concept in the Vexra. And as you've already seen, the animations on this hull is quite involved and really cool. So again, the design for these you already see here in the concepts. The ideas is already put into the concept. And from there, here's the finished and textured 3D asset. On the left, with its guns packed in and closed up for warp, while on the right, it has its guns out and ready for fight, ready to fight. And of course, then we also redesigned the Easttar. And here is the complete model with texture work in progress. The hull variations included an expanded drone bay for the Easttar and also some additional tech areas. Here's the final model with its weapon platforms out. And on the right, you see it from the back, with you see the additional drone bays. Of course, we have a short video. You might have already seen it on Thursday, but I definitely think it's worth another watch. So let's have a look at that. Thank you. Yeah, it's pretty sweet. I think it's the first time we've ever managed to, yeah. Ah, it's cool. That's the first time we managed to have all the guns retract into a ship like that. I think it's very cool. But before we get ready to release the Vexar and the Ishtar, we do have a couple of other redesigns ready. It's probably the first ships we've ever redesigned before they've actually been flown by any players. And obviously I'm talking about the Concorde ships. These hulls will be able to fly for the first time with the Concorde Aerospace faction. And for that occasion, we thought we'd have a look at some of the hulls that we'd be putting out, because those guys are also pretty old. First up, we had the Concorde frigate, the Pacifier, and here we have it in its current state. This one is the Directive Enforcement Department, or DET version, so this is not the one you guys will be flying. But starting up from here, we many times start off producing a bunch of thumbnail sketches based on the original ship and defining shapes. You'll be trying to find shapes and silhouettes that reads well and works for the type of ship you're working with. Here's some more thumbnail sketches, starting to focus in on the main shapes. Also, while imagining how these will work with any potential animation. And again, this will be thrown back and forth from concept to 3D. Until you arrive at exactly the shape and style you're looking for. And here we're getting pretty close to something we wanted. And in the end, we've arrived at the Pacifier concept. Then you just model it, UV and texture it, and before long you will be flying around in New Eden in your very own spaceship police frigate. Or not, because you know you guys won't be flying the dead version, so I think this aerospace version of the Pacifier is pretty goddamn cool too. I actually really grew fond of this color scheme while working on them. And we also have a cruiser to redesign, and here we have the Enforcer, as we all know it today. And again, based off the original design, we started the concept phase by producing a number of thumbnails. For the new Concorde designs, we really wanted to go for a more sleek and not too busy hull design. So while you still have all your tech details and drone bays, electronics and boosters, booster mechanics underneath, on the top, we really wanted to keep the hull surface mainly clean, flowing plating. You see that, and you see us working on the wing designs and paint schemes here. And here, without the texture details, we're getting close to a final design on the cruiser. I think we have a video here showing the ship with its final texture details also. And again, the available ship to fly would be the aerospace version. So let's have a look at how that turned out. As you see here, the big plating areas on top almost acts as like an armored shell on top of all the tech beneath. It's pretty cool. Now, as always, we still have other ships in the pipeline in various stages of development. We have the Sin, which I believe we've shown you before. This ship is now in active production. Other hulls in various stages of early concept and pre-production is the Badger and the Tyra. Here we see the concept of variations for this industrial line. And the Rupture, sort of one we're looking at. And the Osprey. Yes. So that's about it for redesigns this time around. Moving on, let's have a look at what's been going on with the ongoing structures effort. The Upwell Consortium has not been idle. So since first bringing us the citadels in the shape of the Astrohus, the Fortisar, and the Keepstar, and since revolutionizing the industrial landscape of New Eden with the Raitaru, the Aspel, and the Sotillo. But now they're building us new dreams in the shape of the refineries. The refineries comes in two variations, a medium and a large one, as opposed to the three. And in designing these, we wanted to pick up from where we left off with the two previous structure lines. This meant, again, going for a more modular approach, where different structure elements can be reused across different sizes. So we began the design process around structural elements that could be common for different refineries at different operational levels and capacity, while also working with and using elements to create different structures and different sizes and different silhouettes. But there were other things to consider when designing these structures. There was a small detail such as moon mining. The moon mining in itself sets some design challenges and requirements right off the bat. So since you can place the refineries anywhere around the moons, we would have to design a mining rig that could basically mine in every which direction without coming into conflict with the structure around it. And for this, we would have to come up with something new. It just did not seem feasible that this guy would do the job. So we would have to design a new turret, a bigger turret. And so we did that. This is the moon mining turret. It's slightly bigger than your standard civilian miner, and it's about 5 times bigger than the Chimera. So it's pretty big. Now that we have a huge ass mining turret, we need to design a way for this to be able to work at any angle from any position on the refinery structure. And the choice we made here would have a significant impact on how we would go about designing the refineries themselves. We simply went with the design of placing a huge circular mounting rig for the turret, like so, and we would simply mount the turret on that. This gives me a complete 360-degree mining capability radius. And now that we have the mining rig set up, we would simply use our modular refinery structure, superstructure components to build our structure within the confines of this rig. So here we have the finished medium refinery model. What this also means is that we have to build the large refinery model within the same confines of this mining rig, which is absolutely fine. Here it is, the large refinery model. And although it's confined within the same horizontal space as the medium structure, the structure itself is more massive and easily reflects the functionality and capacity of the larger structure. Here we have the two next to each other. And again, we see we can easily tell the medium refinery structure from the large with the massive refining units and much more voluminous superstructure on the large one. And so here we have a few more previews of the medium refinery, including its holograms and perimeter and runway lights. You'll notice, as I mentioned earlier, that between this and the large structure, we managed to reuse a lot of the structural elements that are defining for the refineries. And here, on the large refinery, we also have added some of the exterior environment elements to lights and holograms. You see here the enormous superstructure that extends from the back of the Tatara, giving it its volume. There again, the large structure. And again, we have a small video showing these structures before we move on from here. Let's have a look at that. Yeah, so we can't wait for you guys to get your hands on these structures. But one is the structures themselves, another is the functionality they bring. Moon mining. We've already touched briefly on it when we looked at the moon mining turret. But I also just want to show a bit of the mining process itself. This is quite a thing for us, both from a technical and artistic standpoint, to rip a huge piece out of one of our moons and then tractor it into space and blow it up. It's not something we've done before. So on the art side, we obviously had to do some work on creating some stunning visuals for this process. While also realistically being able to sell this to our graphics programmers. So here are some concepts on proposed visuals from the moon's surface. We see setting off detonations around in a circular perimeter to loosen and rip up a huge chunk of moon rock. And obviously you need smoke and dust and all kinds of things around when that happens. And when that's all said and done and you pull up the moon chunk, you need a crater, of course, in your moon from where your chunk came. And here's a concept in mining sequence that you might have seen before. We see the enormous mining turrets mounted on the refinery rig. Here it detonates and rips off the actual moon rock and then tractors it up towards the refinery and in space. Once within specified range, you blow up this huge chunk of rock from its core, creating a huge mineable rock belt. And then you want to have all your mining buddies come in and mine away before someone else shows up. Now, that's about all we have to show you for today. But before we sign out, I just want to touch on something you might remember from CCP Siegel's keynote on Thursday. With all the leaps and bounds of progress we've made in the graphics sites over the last years, and probably more now than ever with both our 3D assets constantly pushing the limits of size and fidelity, and our awesome effects, suns and explosions, also with improvements such as post-processing and environment templates, we as CCP Siegel expressed dare to dream a little bit bigger going forward about how far we can push our environments, like beyond what we can even imagine today. So we in TriLambda have been concepting this future, both in 3D, as you see here, and in concept, looking to where we can take you, the pilots of New Eden, and what kind of environments and challenges we can help create by envisioning new worlds and new opportunities, all within the existing universe of EVE Online. We want to build environments not just brackets on your overview or small structures dispersed around you. We want them to engulf you, and we want you to become like a small entity in the vast environment surrounding you. Because the scale of EVE is already daunting, and it's not space we lack. And so with concepts like these and visions of future worlds within the New Eden, we already know, we want to inspire ourselves and all of you, our community and players. I mean, how about being able to maneuver around, you know, within a vast glacial environment like this, or fiery asteroid environment like this, surrounded by toxic clouds and smoldering embers and rocks the sizes of citadels? I mean, we want you to feel the scale of the world you navigate, whether you're flying your bowhead class freighter or frigate, relative to, you know, the space around you, you feel equally tiny. So those are some of the things we strive for with these concepts of future visions, and I hope you share our enthusiasm for these kind of visual goals.
Yeah, so that's kind of all we have for now. But since we're here, we thought we'd play the new Explosions video to end this. Yeah, let's just do that.
Yeah, hasn't been played here before, has it? No. Let's do that.
So that was, of course, featuring the most powerful frigate in the universe.
Well, that was awesome. Thank you very much for having us. That's it for us. And thank you much, very much for a great FanFest so far. If you have any questions, we won't be taking questions now. We have a questions and answers session now in Serenity at 1 o'clock with the yacht team being there. So go there and ask away. Or if you have any comments or anything else, then show up there. Thank you very much.
Thank you.